this is Jean Marie Ward for Buzzy Magazine. With me today is Martha Wells, the multi-award-winning author of the books of the Raksura, The Fall of ile-rien, and the tales of everybody's favorite snarky cyborg, The Murderbot Diaries. Welcome, Martha.
Hi, thank you.
I confess, All Systems Red, the first novella in The Murderbot Diaries, was my first real introduction to your work. From the opening line, the voice of your cyborg security unit protagonist jumped off my screen. It was so snarky, so real, so human. How did Murderbot land on your keyboard?
Well, I'm not really sure. Originally, it was going to be a short story. I was finishing up the end of The Harbors of the Sun, which is the last Raksura novel, and I just got the idea for a story about basically a security person who was enslaved and supposedly controlled by the governor module, and who had actually freed itself and was faced with the choice of letting the people it was guarding die or revealing to them what it was, and I'm just that it was free. So I don't really know where that came from. I really liked the idea. I knew it had to be in a science fiction setting, and I kind of, you know, just meant to write down a few lines so I'd remember it, because I needed to go back and work and finish The Harbors of the Sun. And then I ended up writing like 5 pages of the scene where Dr. Mensa comes and knocks on the cubicle wall and actually talks to Murderbot like it's a coworker, which kind of sets off the rest of the story. So I don't really know where the idea came from. It was just like a really vivid scene. And I finished Harbors of the Sun and then started the very next day started to work on All Systems Red. And it was just, I realized immediately it needed to be longer. And my short story was originally going to have a sad ending, and that just was not working. And I didn't want it to have a sad ending because I was really falling in love with the character. And I just decided that it really needed to be novella length, and by the time I got to it, I had changed my mind a lot about the ending. I was flipping back and forth about whether it would stay with Dr. Mensa or leave, and I finally, when I got to the end, I knew which one it was going to do. Mm-hmm.
The ending wrote itself, if you will. It told you what it wanted to be?
It didn't want to write itself up until I got there, and once I got there, I really knew that this is how it had to go.
Is this something that happens to you often, that a character will come in and land and suddenly take over the story you thought you were writing?
Yeah, in some ways it does. I love it when that happens.
Yes.
It kind of happened with Stone in the books of the Raksura. I didn't originally envision that character as being that vital to the story, but he does become that vital. It happened with a lot of characters, actually, with Pearl and Malachite. And it's always nice when that happens. I think that's a good sign for me that what I'm working on is going well.
That something's going right.
Yeah.
You mentioned the books of the Raksura, and I also mentioned the tales of The Fall of ile-rien, mm-hmm. which is a historical fantasy. Both of those are fantasies, but you've got a deep background in science fiction and science fiction mm-hmm. fandom, and you've also written tie-in novels for the worlds of Stargate and Star Wars. Mm-hmm. How did those tie-in novels and the work you did on that influence the vision of the future that you created for Murderbot, or did it? Did you decide to go in a different direction?
I think what it really did for me is before I did the Stargate Atlantis books, I had been pretty much writing ile-rien. City Bones and Wheel of the Infinite were in there, but they were books that I did a lot of research on, that the real world elements that came into them, just the kind of the material culture and that I wanted to create, and just the environment that I wanted to create. And so I was sticking really carefully to, you know, my research and doing a lot of really strict world building, especially with the ile-rien books. Which were based on, the first ones in sort of based on 17th century France, and then they move up in time to about the 1920s. So, and when I wrote the tie-in books, there was a lot of really, I was able to do neat things like the characters, you know, they have the jumpers, so they can move very fast. They can go use the gates to get to different worlds. It felt really freeing because it felt like there was a lot more, being able to have the advanced technology. I mean, you could do a lot more things. I could make up a lot more. It kind of freed me up to kind of look at different possibilities. And because I'd really been in that really historical fantasy mindset for quite a while. And so it just kind of really, I think that's what kind of led to the books of the Raxura, is like I was thinking about things like, it would be neat to do a fantasy novel. I'd used, you know, the 1920s style passenger liner in the Fall of ile-rien trilogy, which was really cool because it enabled us, the characters, to move across, you know, this one side of the world and see a lot of different things along the way. But the it just kind of like, I've thought about how characters being able to travel faster in a fantasy novel and how much more interesting that would be, and that kind of led to, you know, thinking about flying and means of travel and the flying boats that the Raxura find, and then the being able to shapeshift into the winged forms, and just thinking about things in different ways and kind of getting out of I think I was in a rut, basically, and doing those two books really got me out of that rut.
And opened you to different possibilities.
Different possibilities and different, you know, different types of adventures, mm-hmm. basically.
Mm-hmm. And Murderbot's certainly different from ile-rien, no question about that. Many of your signature characters, Murderbot, obviously, as well as Moon, the protagonist of several of the books of Raxura, are fish out of water, looking for a place that feels like home. Mm-hmm. What draws you to themes of isolation and loneliness?
Well, I think it goes back to being a little kid who felt very isolated and lonely. I was always interested in science fiction and fantasy, and back at that time, this was like the 70s when I was growing up, you just kind of, there wasn't this, it's hard to describe because there just wasn't this fandom, and it's accessible fandom like it is now. I mean, there was no internet, so it was very difficult to connect with other fans. You had to do it in person, and you had to know where they were. It's like it took me so long to find Star Wars fanzines, and I just happened to stumble on a little ad for them in the back of Starlog magazine, and you know, sent a reply to it, and then got all this information about fanzines. If I hadn't done that, I would never have heard of them, you know, until I got online finally, because it's just like, you, to find out about fanzines, you had to have a fanzine because all the ads were in the back. So getting new people into that kind of fandom was just really difficult. So, you know, you're sort of isolated, and you know, I've had a lot of problems with depression and anxiety, which is also feels very isolating. So I think it all really comes out of that.
Not all of these characters that you have are human, obviously. You know, we're talking cyborg security units. We're talking sentient computers. We're talking flying lizard people who shapeshift. What's the secret to getting ordinary wingless humans, not only to read about them, but to relate to them and identify with them, identify with somebody so different from themselves?
Well, sometimes they don't. Sometimes people just stop and their imagination can't make that leap. Even though when you read the books, I feel like the characters are very relatable because they think about things in different ways, and they, you know, they interact with their environment in very different ways, but a lot of their problems are the same problems humans have. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's not that much different about it. But some people really can't get over that physical being, that this is a person who is not human. Mm-hmm. And I've had that conversation with people where they say, how can you write about something that's not human? How can it have a perspective? And it's like, you can be a person without being human. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes they don't relate to it at all. Actually, the Cloud Roads took about 2 years for my agent to sell it. Mm-hmm. And that was the complaint from editors that turned it, some of the others who turned it down, was that it was, nobody will want to read it because there's no humans in it.
Mm-hmm. But you find that otherness very important on many levels, and you work to preserve it. How do you preserve the otherness, you as a human, writing non-human characters, and why is it important?
I think it gets back to basic point of view, mm-hmm. And that's one big thing I'll see when I'm helping people who are just starting to write. It's very easy to fall into writing from your own viewpoint and not the character's viewpoint, because, I mean, you know, you may be a small, asthmatic woman. You're not going to be able to run up these steps. You're not going to be able to do this fight scene. You're not going to be able to do these things. To you, it would seem like, you know, just an incredible, dangerous, horrible thing. But you have to think about who your character is. And for them, it may not be nearly as dangerous. If they have experience of this sort of thing before, you have to think about all that. And writing alien characters or non-human characters or machine intelligences is just, you have to think about their physicalness and how that would affect their thinking and what their experiences would have been, what the things that they would have no experience with. And you just have to really keep that in mind and think about your point of view at all times. And I think it gets easier with practice.
Mm-hmm.
But even in my first probably 2 or 3, 4 books, I would have problems where I realized I'd fallen out of my character's point of view and into my point of view, and that's why the scene wasn't working. I was writing about what I would have done and what I thought was a good idea, which is mostly to not do anything in my way, as opposed to what the character would think, which is to, you know, get in there and do these things and take care of the situation. So it's really point of view, I think, is the key to it.
And why is it important?
I don't know. It's just always been something I've been drawn to. It's something I like to read when mm-hmm. people do a really good job with non-human characters. I think it's just putting yourself in someone else's skin in the... and that's what we do whenever we read, basically, but taking that to basically the ultimate point is putting yourself into the skin of someone who's not human.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Unfortunately, we're coming up against the end of our time, and I feel really bad because I could listen to you for a long, long time.
Oh, thank you.
But I do have two questions we always ask, and one of them is, what are you working on now?
I'm working on more Murderbot.
Okay, great. Your fans will be thrilled to hear that. And is there anything you like to add?
I don't think so. You can find me online at marthawells.com. I'm also on Twitter, and there'll be links to that, for my Goodreads and all that kind of thing from there.
Great. Okay. Well, that's it. Thank you, Martha.
Oh, thank you.
And thank you for Buzzy Magazine.